How were you captured? What happened?
Well, they first came up to us with a bunch of German youths, and they were brandishing those little daggers that they had, you know, and these were 13-year-old kids. Well, they had to be younger than 16 because Hitler was conscripting them at 16 for the military. But anyway, they were having a good time with the American Terrorflieger. Well, about this time, the Volkstrom came in and chased them away and got us in, was a Stanley steamer type thing. They were actually using wood generating steam, and this was driving the automobile. They had gone to that extent over there. They had no fuel, you know. And in fact, one way, on the way into Demmin, where we'd crashed outside of it, there was a little hill, and they made them, everybody get, I was still hurting pretty bad and they didn't get me out, but the rest of the crew had to get out and help push the bus up over the hill so it could get in. It didn't have that much power.
But. And so did you go, where did you go from there then?
Well, they kept us there, I think it was 2 or 3 days, I can't remember exactly now, in this little brig, if you will, but it was an Air Force base, a Luftwaffe base, and they had this little prison type thing, I guess, just, but anyway, we were in there. There was another crew in there with us too, but they wouldn't let us talk to each other. Then they loaded us on a plane, train, took us, first we went through Berlin, but the interrogation was at Frankfurt, yes.
Yeah. Talk about the, well, you know, on that train, how was the train trip down there? I mean, these were dangerous times.
Well, the only time that we encountered any real problem as far as we were, I can't remember the station we were in, but the British were bombing. And they had stopped the train there and they'd taken us off and put us in. And the civilians were really upset. And all I can say is thank God for the German regimentation, because they had been ordered to take us to Frankfurt and they held that the Germans away from us, the civilians. And you can imagine, you know, here you are in a foreign country and you've just bombed them and now you're getting bombed again and here you're being protected, you know. So you could appreciate the fact that the German civilians wanted to kill us. But the soldiers kept them away, and in fact, they gave us a little bowl of gruel of some kind, the same thing that the civilians were getting in there. When they took us in to the interrogation center, they took me into this one, it was a very austere room. It didn't even have a tick for the, it was just a board for the bed and no lavatory facilities or anything like that. And it had one little slot where you could look out into the hallway and a little flag that you were supposed to put up when you needed to go to relieve yourself or something. But looking out, there was a courtyard and it had a little slit there where you could look out onto the courtyard. But how they were regulating the temperature, I don't know, but at times it would get hot and then it would get cold. And this went on for a couple of days, and I guess it was a conditioning type thing. That, and so eventually they called me in. I got into this room, this German officer in there. He had a high rank of some kind, but he was dressed in a Gestapo uniform, very, very proper. And he had a meal laid out in front of him. And he said, called me by name and my rank and everything. That's all I'd given him. And then he started to tell me all about myself. And he knew where I'd gone to school. And of course, this is looking back, in retrospect, it was no big deal because they had spies. The Bund had acquired any information that they needed.
And, reading newspapers and things?
Oh, yeah, sure. What I did was in the paper, and you know, it was no secret.
But were you surprised at the time?
Oh, when he started to talk, his English was better than mine. His grammar was much better. He Well, he actually recited that he had graduated from Columbia University and had a master's degree from Harvard. And, you know, I couldn't get, why are you back here then? But anyway, he eventually laid out a little blueprint. And he says, this is a new secret weapon you've got. We know about it. And at one time, while I was at Bassingbourne, we flew a night mission. And it was very strange because we never flew night missions, you know. And we went over France, and we had a point picked out in the mid-France and went over and turned around and came back. And that's all I knew about the mission. Nobody ever told me anything else. They just said it was a recon mission, and that's all we needed to know. And but apparently they had a synchronized bombing program that they were trying to institute, but it was very hush-hush, very secret, and whether it'd even work or not, I don't know. But
was there, to your knowledge, was there any special equipment or unknown personnel on your plane?
Well, there were several officers that we didn't know about. I mean, they just introduced themselves that they were observing us on this flight. As far as we thought, my God, we're going to start bombing at night. You know, that was the impression that the crew got. And it was a mixed crew. It wasn't a regular crew. The pilot, the co-pilot, and the navigator, and the engineer, it was all that was on the plane, plus these two individuals that went along as observers. So it was, we just had no idea, you know, and they said it's a recon mission. So we thought when we got back, we told them, we thought, well, we're going to start bombing at night. Yeah.
So okay. this German officer puts this drawing, you thought in your head, this might be related, but what did you tell him?
Well, I didn't know at the time. He put it down and he says, now we know this and we know that you've been experimenting and now we know all about this. And it was a regular blueprint, but up in the corner, there was an insert that was missing. And it says, across it says, for top secret for select eyes only, or I can't remember the
designation. And it was in English.
It was in English. They had the diagram in English. And he said, now we understand what this is, but we don't know the triggering mechanism now. Lieutenant Johnson, as soon as you tell us that, why, we'll feed you and everything fine. I made the mistake of, if you know so goddamn much, what are you telling me for?
That's what you said?
Yeah, exactly. And he brought a big German in there, and he jerked me up out of the chair, and he gave me a punch, and I went to the ground, you know, and prod, jumped right back up again, and down I went again. And I thought, hey, you better stay down here. You're not going to survive this. I got a picture that the Germans took right after that interrogation, and it shows the marks on my face where they hit me. But that was the only time I was ever treated badly, but I guess they can say I brought that on myself, you know.
Well, after...
disrespectful to this officer.
What happened after that, then?
Well, then they took me back to the cell, and I laid there on the bench trying to feel sorry for myself. And finally, I had to relieve myself, and I put the signal up. God, it seemed like an eternity before he came in. And finally he came in and he says, you're a bad man. And about that time, there was a disturbance out in the courtyard. And I looked up and here, these Germans were marching in an American. And they lined him up against the wall and pretty soon they shot him. And, and this guard came back in and says, see, that's what we have to do to bad people. And I still had to go badly, but God, it must have been 2 hours later before they ever let me relieve myself. Well, nothing happened. Didn't hear any more about it. Well, later on, we found out it was a guise that they were using just to extract information. It was a posed thing. Nobody was hurt. It was just a German dressed in an American uniform. And when he slumped down, it was blank shells and he slumped down. But apparently they realized that I didn't know anything about it, so they didn't pursue it any farther.
went to Hamburg, went to a railroad station, got on a train. I had two guards then. Got on a train, and all the windows were already blown out of it. There were no glass windows or anything like that, and it was people traveling free. And the train would only go maybe a couple miles and quit and jerk and back up and do all these different things and go through a little town that was all beat up. And it took about, I've forgotten how many days it took to get to Frankfurt, but it took more than a week. And that's not very far. It was all because of the bombings, and we were strafed, and not where I, the train I was in, I mean the car I was in, but they were having trouble, and they had workmen, slaves working on the rail yards and all that kind of stuff, and they'd send one guy would go up and get stuff at the store or whatever it is, and they're all kind of beat up, all these stores, and they wouldn't offer me anything.
I was going to say, were you getting anything to eat?
Well, no, not in the beginning. But I finally got something, you know, occasionally. But and then a lady would be sitting over there, and she'd have a great big purse and pull out a big slab of bologna and some cheese and start eating. And you'd be drooling, you know, and bread or something. A German lady, but they wouldn't give you anything. They didn't really have that much, I don't think.
On the train, were there other POWs with you?
Well, there. I'm sure there was some more in there, but I didn't see in that particular seat I was sitting in or the car.
Had you been interrogated up to this point?
No. I was going to Dulag Luft 1, you know what I'm talking about, near Aberzuhl or Wetzlar, or they call it different names there, and out of Frankfurt. That's where. So we got to the Frankfurt station, and then the airline sirens went off, and I was on crutches, so they had about, by that time they did have it, about a half a dozen POWs. So they put us down in the boiler room in the railroad station. That's, they had boiler rooms because it was cold, you know. And I thought that was a dumb, that would be the worst place. I wouldn't go near a boiler room if I were being bombed, you know. And that was the worst place to be, because if a bomb got anywhere near you, you'd blow up with the boilers. So after that was over with, we got, I was with these six guys, but they had about 10 guards in. And we got on the trolley car and went out of town there, and the streets were very wide. I thought the streets were kind of pretty, but of course the town was beat up, the city.
Yeah.
And went down and got, and then we finally got the end of the line. When a couple of people came up, the public wanted to get a hold of you and that type of thing, and you were just lucky you had the guards there to keep them off.
What were the guards like?
They were usually pretty quiet, and most of them were pretty young. I didn't think they could even fire the gun, especially when you're kind of used to shooting around with 50 caliber stuff, you know. So we went down there, and then we had to wait about an hour. And it had been snowing, and we had to go up this hill. And they were waiting for more prisoners. Pretty soon there were about 25 or 30 prisoners. And I was the one who was on crutches, and so I was the slowest one. And they put me at the front. And so we started going up the hill. Well, my ankle was getting a little better, but I mean, I was having trouble getting on, and it was slippery and snowing and wet and icy and all that stuff. And the guards and the guys in the back, the guards, they were lagging, and so they bayoneted them in the rear end. You know, they were kind of mean to them, rough to them, with their rifle butts and stuff, because that kept me going faster, you know. Finally, I think we walked about a mile or a mile and a half, or whatever it was, into Wetzlar. And there was a camp on this side, and there was something on that side, and I figured which side are we going to go on, you know. And they took us in the, I've forgotten now, but we turned in the left, I believe. And that was the interrogation center, Wetzlar. And they had solitary confinement there. That's what they put you in.
So you're separated from everybody at this point.
I was in there by myself. I mean, I don't know what happened to those other guys. They weren't following me or anything, but they put me in this little room. It was a small window up on top, and it had a bench, and then there was, I thought it was a heater at the end of the bed, but there was, wasn't plugged in or anything. There wasn't any heat or anything, or a bucket, and that's all there was to it. And you were locked in, and you were at the mercy of the guards and whatever it is. And you had one blanket, which is not too bad, but when it's below zero outside, it's cold in there.
Talk about, were you interrogated?
The food was lousy anyway.
Oh, were you interrogated there?
Yes.
Tell us about the interrogation.
Well, I finally, about 4 days or so later, they just came and knocked on the door and told me I'd go that way, you know, Rouse or something. And they had two guards then, and I went to this place and inside, and I remember turning left, and there were other officers around. There were a lot of prisoners there then, officers in particular. And I remember there was a guy from Argentina, pilot, P-47 pilot, that's what he told me he was. And a couple of guys, I sort of could talk to him a little bit. You weren't supposed to, but they'd tell you, and then they'd tell you not to talk and all that stuff. So I went into the interrogation. And so then I went in there, and there was this colonel, and maps all over the walls, and they had racks of like generators and radio equipment and all this kind of stuff all over the thing, and all these great big thick books here, things about that thick. I couldn't figure out what that was. And then they had a lot of stuff, and he had a desk with his pictures on it with his family and all these things. Well, I found that out later that was his family. And so we asked me my name, and I gave him name, rank, and serial number, like you always do. And then he wanted to know what group I was in, and I didn't say too much. I just didn't say anything. He said, "I already know what's a group and stifle, you know." He said, "I know all that." He says, "Your buddies, you know, he was talking about Morrison or whatever the name, I forgot their names right now, but they were here the other day." He said, "I know." He said, "You're the last," and all that kind of stuff. And he rattled all this off, and he said, "Well, what school do you go to?" And he said, and I started to say something. He said, "I know what school you went to." And he pulled out one of these big books, and he was looking there, and he said, "Went to Los Angeles High School," you know, all this stuff like that. And I had all this stuff, and he said, "I know your commander. Commander and all that kind of thing." You know, they knew who Joe Mueller was, and they knew a lot because they had these newspaper clippings.
What were you thinking at this point that he knows so much?
I was amazed. But then I think he was being fairly nice to me, right? And then finally, he pointed on the map, and he says, "Where's MacArthur?" This is a map of the Philippines up there. "Where's MacArthur?" Just like that. Well, it had nothing to do with MacArthur, what he wanted. And I didn't know what he wanted, but I had a hunch. And, "Where's MacArthur?" And I looked up at the map, and I said, "Well, I don't know, somewhere around Luzon, maybe." And later he kind of told me he was amazed that we knew so much about where the other armies were, what was going on. But what he was after, what he was already asking me about equipment. We had put, several weeks before that, we'd put I call it a flak suppressor. That's not what, I'd forgotten the name of it, like a G-box or something. And we put that on the plane, and it reflects the flak image that goes to the ground. It makes it like 1,500 feet less. And it put out a signal. Anyway, the crew chief had me down there at the airplane. This was several weeks before, and we put this, he was showing me what he was putting in there. I've just forgotten the name of it. I keep forgetting the name of it. Let's look at it that way. And that's what it's supposed to do. It's supposed to confuse men on the ground with they're measuring when the shell is supposed to go off, right? So, that's what he wanted to know, something about that. I could see it over there, but I didn't look at it really, because Look at a generator or something. But that was one of the things. And then he pointed to that, but he had a pointer. That scared me a little bit, because like he's going to tap you on the shoulder, you know? It's, you know, it's supposed to intimidate you, I believe. I kind of figured that out anyway. And he was intimidating because he had a very hard, guttural type voice. And then he sat down and he had a picture, and I looked at that picture, and he said, oh, he says, that's my wife and son. And he says, they live in Stuttgart. He says, why do you bomb Stuttgart? Just scared the hell out of me, you know? I mean, that really did frighten me. I thought that guy was going to slit my throat. You know, that's the way you felt about it. And he said, do you know that it takes over like 2 weeks? But he was talking very broken English to get a letter to Stuttgart from here, you know, that type of thing. And, you know, his talk. And I think he did it on purpose to shock me, you know. And then he asked me about my ankle, and how, because I was on a crutch, and how I was getting along. And he said, you were like, you'd be all right. He was actually nice. I mean, he wasn't trying to beat you up or anything. It was just trying to get some information out of you. And they wanted to know about that equipment, that's all. I know there's a couple other things happened, but I can't remember what they are right now.
How many times were you interrogated?
I've just once.
So
see, all my whole crew had already been, not Ron Nash and they hadn't been through there because they were in the hospitals. But the rest of the crew had all been through there.
So the interrogation.
So they already knew everything about where we're from, what we're doing, and everything.
So where did it go from there then?
Well, they left there. I think I stayed there another couple of days, and they put me in a room where there were some other officers in there, and they were talking about the front lines, and finally I was fooling around looking at the ceiling here and underneath there, and I found a couple of bugs in there. Where they were listening to these officers talking. I was in a room with about four officers. I think it was some kind of a room anyway, that was bugged. And then also the latrines were bugged. I could see the wires. I mean, I wasn't that dumb. I didn't. But ordinarily you wouldn't pay any attention to it, but I was looking for sort of, see if anything was funny.
So they
sent you across to the other side of the compound, or where it was, which they turned right this time, and you go across there, and they have a place where the Red Cross, our government gave the money to the Red Cross, and Red Cross gave you overcoat, shoes. I didn't have any shoes. I had, you know, the flying boots, and toiletries and a few things like that, a towel. They did allow us to take a shower. I had one shower, but at Nuremberg, I think as a day, that's maybe the couple of days, we were on a truck to Nuremberg. That's all I can remember there. And went to Nuremberg, and that's a camp there. There are at least 10,000 people there.
Then they took us to the railway station, and I think there was only two, maybe three guards went with us. They took us down through the Ruhr Valley to Frankfurt, and arriving there late that Sunday night. And the guards had there was less German civilians in there, and the guards had a hard time getting us through them. They spit at us and threw things at us, and they put us on a streetcar, took us out to the interrogation center and put us in solitary confinement. And we were each interrogated when we was at Bonn, and then Sunday night before they took us to our room, they interrogated us.
Were you physically abused in the interrogation?
No. I can't think of the man's name. The man who was in charge of interrogation there, he was actually a German private. He made corporal just at the end of the war. But he was in charge, and he had been living in South Africa, and he felt it was his duty to come back and join the German army. His wife was English, But he, his philosophy was to treat you humanely, courteously, and never threaten us. Although I remember one room that I was interrogated in had a couple of rifles hanging on a wall, like a display, and I remember a black snake whip. And that kind of worried me. Mm. But I was interrogated again twice on Monday, twice on Tuesday, twice on Wednesday, and once Friday morning, then they stopped. But after the either the first or second interrogation on Monday, they took me out. They didn't take me back that little 4-foot-wide room and about 8, 10, 12 feet long, and put me in a large room at the end of this wing of this building. I had a window on the two sides. I had a regular bed, a little table, and a chair, and an easy chair. And I didn't know what was happening. So Tuesday evening, I'd realized that they weren't locking my door when they left me or brought my meal or took me to the restroom. So I think it was Wednesday morning. They brought me back after interrogation, and I didn't hear the door lock clicking. So in those rooms, you had to keep your shoes on the floor outside the doors. So I opened the door and looked out, and I couldn't see or hear anybody. So I moseyed, went out and went down to the T section there, and I could hear English language down there. So I peeked around the corner and I couldn't see a germ or anyway, but I couldn't see anybody. So I went to the right towards where they took me to the restroom. And then I realized that there was doors had been opened on the wall and attached, that swung up. And this was a canteen being run by a couple British soldiers. So that had never been opened so when I was taken down to the restroom, and so I didn't know it was there. So I asked if I could get stuff to take a shower and a shave and all. And they said, yeah, they gave me everything I need, towels and soap and a toothbrush and everything. So I went in. I must spend 10 minutes in there showering, and 10 or 15 minutes. So I come out and I checked the windows in there. Everyone almost barred, so I couldn't sneak out. So I returned the stuff to them, and they thanked me, and I started walking back and never saw a German guard. I went back to my room. So I decided, if they don't lock that tonight, I'm going to walk out of here. And that very evening, after this guard served me my measly meal, he closed the door, then he opened it up and stuck his head in and asked me what my rank was. I told him a staff sergeant. His eyes got bigger. He slammed that door shut and locked it. Here, we figured out later that this is where they put the high ranking officers in a room like that. And
they had thought you were a high ranking officer. That
the guard had brought me back the first time, or put me in there, thought I was a high ranking officer. And, and then, of course, when I told the rest of the crew that on Friday I was taken to another room in another building, and that's when I met the rest of the crew. They had already finished their interrogations the day before. I think why I was interrogated more was I could, as an engineer, I should have known the tail number on that airplane. Being new plane, I just could not remember that number. And they, I think, thought maybe I wasn't a member of the crew, that I was on that plane for some other reason.
And, did you notice any particular techniques as far as their interrogation or tricks or things of that sort?
Well, they, of course, kept asking personal questions about myself and my family and about my squadron and group. And finally, he pulled the drawer open and pulled his paper out. He had down there, he knew that I graduated from Ligonier High School.
he knew what squadron I was from, and of course they get that from the planes if they can, when they crash, and there are many other ways. And it was something else he told me. But I found out this interrogator wrote a book, and I got a hold of that, and he told me how they got that information. That the my mother was an assistant reporter for the local newspaper. If she had any news, she'd call. Well, they always put in, if any of us come back on leave, furlough or something, they'd put that in the paper. And there was a German spy around there that they would clip this stuff out and send it to the German embassy in Portugal. And then the embassy would get it up to Germany. And that's where they got a lot of the information from us. And when he, I don't think this fellow interrogated me. I think he just interrogated the higher ranking officers. But he tells a story of Colonel Gobreski. He was a lieutenant colonel, was a P-47 ace from Morrill City, Pennsylvania. That they had a dossier on him. He had pictures only taken like a week or two before the colonel was shot down in England with General Doolittle. That's how good their spies were.
Boy. Well, after they finished with you, what happened?
Well,
after
that Friday night, the British come over and bombed Frankfurt, which was very scary. We had a lot of British and Canadians with us there, and they were they told us they were dropping the blockbuster bombs, those big fellows. And our building really shook, but none of them landed near us. And the next day we were taken to Dulag Luft at Wetzlar, Germany. And that they took our flying clothing from us and issued us some GI clothing. And they gave us an American Red Cross clothing suitcase. It had a lot of winter clothing in it, and socks, and usually five or six packs of cigarettes or a pipe, and three or four packs of tobacco. All kinds of toilet articles and things that we'd need. And a day or two later, then they separated the enlisted men from the officers and put us on a train and took us up through Berlin to a place called Kiefheide. It was just south of the southern border of the Baltic Sea. And I was there till 2nd of February when they started evacuating the campground to keep us away from the Russians.
Which Stalag was that?
That was Stalag 4. It's all enlisted men. Air Force. Both camps were Air Force people. Now, at the end of the war, we got some other Army people in there, too.
How many months were you there at Stalag 4?
About 5 months.
When you look back on that young kid that went over to Europe to fight, I mean, what's your sense of it? What do you think about now when you look back?
We wanted to see action. And that was, knowing our chance of survival on those bombing missions was so low that I didn't realize that until after I started flying.
When you look back, are you proud of your time in service?
Yes, as I stayed in for 25 years, and 6 months later I was asked by a wing commander to come back and work with him for him as a civilian employee, and so I worked another 13 and a half years with the Air Force. So I had over 38 years service to the Air Force.